It's great fun.
More addictive than any drug.
Really exhilarating.
This is power sport. It's our highlight, our passion.
It's mid-January in the Val Mustaya in Switzerland. Sled dog drivers, mushers from all over Europe, gather in the mountain village of Lü. Tomorrow sees the start of the Alpen Trail, an 8-day sled dog race from Unterengadin to Sexten in South Tyrol. Lutz Binzer from Allgäu in Germany is one of the main organisers and also a participant in the Alpine race. He's arrived with 12 dogs.
Camillo, ich hilf dir nicht. Du kannst da alleine rein.
A race like this requires lots of preparation, of course, and if there's no snow, the time and money was spent for nothing. That's why we decided on such a high route, so we can pretty much count on snow. Even so, we've still had to cancel the race on two occasions.
There's plenty of snow this time. But even at nearly 2,000 meters, it quickly turns soft in the sun. Martin Dickel and his father Bernd have only taken part in short sprints so far. The Alpen Trail is their first long-distance race.
At the moment, I'm just happy that we've arrived and can let the dogs out. Getting here was a bit chaotic because of the conditions. Now we're here, we can breathe easy.
As soon as the dogs arrive, they're all examined. But Yoshi needs to be coaxed. Yoshi doesn't like vets. Sylvia Ulrich looks as if she can't wait to get started. She won the race last year with a team of 6 dogs.
I do this so I don't get so nervous. It's occupational therapy. It's one of the reasons we waxed the runners the day before.
Although it doesn't work for everyone, Claudia Falk finds that it actually winds her up. The musher Sylvia Ulrich needs to beat is Norwegian Bjørn Petersen.
I'm taking a chance this year. I have 2 young dogs in the team, which may work out or may be a disaster. Young dogs often misjudge their stamina. They dash off, burn up too much energy and run out of steam before the end.
Nearly all of Claudia Falk's dogs are young. She's been out of racing for a number of years and is now building up a new team.
It's nice seeing the dogs develop and, when they're older, knowing that you can rely on them. With young dogs, you always have to be prepared for surprises.
The Val Mustayer borders on the Finchgau Valley in South Tyrol. The old Benedictine monastery, the Monasterium in Latin, gave the valley its name. It was reportedly built on the orders of Charlemagne, an act of gratitude for surviving a snowstorm in the nearby Umbrai Pass. In Lü, teams of either 6 or 8 dogs set off at intervals on a 40-kilometer route. Sylvia Ulrich and her husband Alfred are taking part with 2 sleds this year, each pulled by 6 dogs.
We're often asked whether we know the names of our dogs, and we can't help smiling at that, because we raise nearly all of them ourselves. So, of course we know their names. We know their whole background. They're like children to us.
As soon as they're in harness, the bundles of energy are eager to start. These dogs are made for running, and those who love them have to share their passion for the chase. Heini Winter from Augsburg is one of the most experienced mushers here. He and his large teams have won many Alpen trails.
I've also done a bit of horse riding, but no other sport has so much energy, so much power, and takes so much to make it work.
The mushers direct their dogs with verbal commands. The term mush comes from the French marche, meaning run, the command used by the first French-Canadian sled dog drivers. The passion for races like this also originated in North America.
We're better known in Alaska than we are here because dog sledding is the number one sport there. It's reported in all the papers. So are the European results. The Alaskans are very interested in the Alpen Trail because they find it incredible. They don't have mountains like ours. Parts of the route are across high alpine terrain, and the dogs need special training to negotiate it. They have to become accustomed to running up very steep slopes, and they have to respond to commands because on downhill slopes especially, the risk of injury for the dogs is acute. If ambition gets the better of the driver and he rides downhill too fast, he risks injuring his dogs.
Races in Alaska are long and flat. The rugged Alps present very different challenges for man and dog.
This is a very demanding sport. Once you've seen the slopes you have to race up, you realize that only trained athletes have a chance of winning here.
Pressing on to Gouda Tamangur, Europe's highest stone pine forest. The name means the wood at the back, and the trees can live to be more than 800 years old. It's a mystical place. People here see the gnarled trees as a symbol of the perseverance of local Romansh culture. The mushers' first destination is Schkal, one of the most remote villages in Switzerland. Only three people live here during winter. The access road is now closed, and the village only really reachable by touring skis or horse-drawn sleigh. At the resting place in Schkal, everyone waits until the last sled has arrived. Then they all head back to Lü. The competition takes place in an air of friendly rivalry, but veterans like Heini Winter would naturally like to win again.
Not fantastic, I'm not really happy.
Sylvia, last year's winner in the smaller sled class, is also ambitious.
It's too warm for my dogs. All the dogs are struggling to cope with the high temperature, but mine more than others. Maybe it's because they are so big and black. I don't know.
For 600 years, silver was mined here. Today, the former mining village is a holiday resort, a popular place in the summer. In the middle of Schkal stands a well commemorating the last bear shot in Switzerland. The landlord of the Gasthaus Major still has photos of it.
We put this together to tell the story of the last bear that was shot here in Schkal in 1904. We have all sorts of mementos.
Und da hat man so verschiedene Sachen zusammengestellt über die ganze Geschichte und so, ja.
We also have a bear trail, and we have a museum where the last bear is on display. Stahl has always had a connection with bears.
A few years ago, another bear made a sudden appearance in the area and caused quite a stir. It came from Trentino in Italy and is now long gone. But at every turn, sculptures recall its visit.
I thought it was great. Many people said, aren't you afraid and don't fewer people come? But I don't think visitor numbers have dropped. The bear was only passing through.
Shortly before the bear turned up in Val Mustaje, shepherd Jachen Planter from Fuldera had what proved to be an inspired idea. He bought two large guard dogs to supplement his herding dogs. They are white Maremma sheepdogs, a breed from the Abruzzo region of Italy. Even as pups, Balu and Samba lived with the herd, which thus became their family.
They are livestock guardian dogs. They protect the sheep from intruders, whether they be wolves, bears, foxes, ravens or tourists. If a stranger appears, they start barking, and a wild animal does not take risks, because if it gets injured, it's dead. So it turns around and walks away. In 2004, I put the sheep out to pasture alone and bought guard dogs. Everyone said that I was mad, that they were unnecessary. In 2005, the bear came along, and my herd was the only one that survived intact.
The sled dogs and mushers making their way back to Lü have reached the pastures where sheep graze in summer. They now face a long and exhausting climb. Heini Winter is over the worst and can cast a glance back at those still struggling. One of a musher's responsibilities is to recognise when a dog's reached its limit. It's then taken out of harness and placed on the sled. Others seem to have no limits. Chief vet Dagmar Kriegler makes sure they have not been doped.
We don't have problems with doping. This is not like horse racing. There's nothing at stake. The winner of this race gets a sled. There's no money involved. A sled dog is a special dog. It's a partner. It's not a piece of sports equipment. We live with our dogs, and it's a very close personal relationship, one that dictates a way of life that creates very strong bonds.
Keeping a pack of dogs is not cheap, and no one here is rich, so there's no budget for luxuries.
Open day. If I'd known, I would have hoovered and cleared up. We do occasionally visit each other's vans, but we spend most of the time outdoors. In the little time I spend in the van, all I need is a place to put my feet up. So this is enough.
Claudia Falk is a physiotherapist by profession, but her Siberian huskies are her passion.
It's their Nordic appearance and their thick coat. I like dogs that you can cuddle. Long hair and good looks are a winning combination in my book, but it may also be because my first dog was a Siberian. They're just my kind of dog.
Sylvia and her husband Alfred keep hounds, which are a cross between huskies and pointers or greyhounds. They're bred more for speed than traditional breeds used for sled dog racing.
They pull harder up the mountain and they help more. And when you see the dogs are up for it, you enjoy pulling out the stops more yourself.
You don't get the same drive with six Siberians. Hounds are also much more affectionate. If I go down there now, I'll have three, four dogs nuzzling up to me. They're like human company.
Huskies, on the other hand, are a very old breed of dog, and they still have a lot of wolf in them.
They do what I say, but they are still independent. They're not really attached to me. I'm sure that if they went somewhere else and were trained and fed and well-treated, it probably wouldn't be long before they forgot me. I realize that. I think I'm more attached to the dogs than the dogs are to me.
3 days later, the whole squad moves 200 kilometers farther east to the land of the Pale Mountains, the Dolomites of South Tyrol. In 2009, this unique mountain landscape was declared a UNESCO World Heritage Site. Next stop is Prags, in a quiet sidearm of the Pusta Valley. In the past, the Prags Valley was famous for its mineral springs. But the golden age of spa travel is long gone, and no new use for the facilities has been found. Here, a bathhouse with a 400-year history faces the prospect of dereliction. The legendary Lake Prags is a magnet for tourists in summer. The only building on its shore is an old grand hotel. It's a building full of stories, which Carolina Heiss inherited from her predecessors. She started renovating the place, but is determined to preserve its historical charm.
Our hotel was always only open in summer. It was a summer hotel. My family had another hotel, a winter hotel in Meran, so this one wasn't used so much. We are the only family-owned hotel of this size in the area. All the others either no longer operate as hotels or have large corporate owners. We don't have the same kind of funds available for investment.
So most of what's here dates back to the time of Carolina's celebrated ancestor, the legendary Frau Emma. She was the pioneer of tourism in South Tyrol and received a Golden Cross of Merit from the Emperor for her services.
Frau Emma had a small hotel in Niederdorf and was actually very progressive for her time. She looked after her guests with painstaking care, organizing excursions and accompanying guests on them herself. One of those excursions brought her to Lake Prags, and she fell in love with the place, with the lake and the area.
High-born guests such as Archduke Franz Ferdinand and his wife spent the summer here.
Frau Emma was the first female member of the Alpine Association and the first woman to engage a mountain guide. Before she did that, she went to the parish priest and asked if it was actually God's will that people should climb the mountains and be escorted by a guide. It was not normal to go up mountains in those days. It was scary. The first climbers were the English and the French. They were the ones who introduced it.
During the gold rush in the 19th century, the only way to travel in the frozen wastes of Alaska was by dog sled. The hardy animals used by the native inhabitants of the Arctic were vital for survival. Alaska's gold diggers were the first to stage dog sled races. But even in the early years, the sport acquired a keen following in Europe. Aficionados who now look to the land that sparked their passion with a dash of pride.
We've had a massive influence on Alaska. In the early days, of course, we just watched and listened and learned, because they had masses of experience, especially over long distances. But we could teach them something about handling dogs, and we did. The way dogs are treated there is now much more humane.
Mushers in Alaska can keep very large packs of dogs, far larger than is possible in densely populated Europe. But the Europeans and their smaller teams have always had a very close relationship, which pays dividends in races. After the race, it's not the musher, but four-legged athlete Snake that gets physio.
We're using magnetotherapy to stimulate blood flow through the muscles and support the body's regenerative processes.
It's a fairly typical descent injury. The dogs strain muscles in their shoulders. The exertion of running downhill is too much for the muscles, and that leaves them limping, like this dog after the last leg. Massage and physiotherapy will sort out the problem, and he'll be able to run again tomorrow.
Snake now gets a massage from Bernd Dickel. Then he'll be left to recover in his warm box. This year's contest is dominated by the Norwegians. By the fifth day of racing, Bjørn Petersen has built up a nearly 30-minute lead over Sylvia.
I'm not driving badly. Everything's going well, actually. I can't complain. The Norwegian is simply better. He has optimal training conditions, of course, and he's a very experienced musher. He's just better, and that's okay.
The Dolomites are a place of myths and legends. The Plätzwiese, for instance, was once the realm of the marmot princess Maltina. She was brought up by the animals here, but fell in love with a prince and left to live with humans. There, when her humble origins were exposed, she became ashamed and embarrassed. And ever since, her mountain, the Hohe Geisel, has frequently turned the same deep red as her blushes. Team talk in Sylvia and Alfred's caravan.
A lead like that's pretty unassailable.
But I want second place.
The couple also make sacrifices. Family holidays are hard to arrange.
We've always taken turns to go on holiday with the children because one of us has to stay at home and look after the dogs. I think it was 9 years ago that my mother looked after the dogs for the last time. When we got back, she said, never again, and we've been holidaying in shifts ever since.
One of us has to stay at home with the dogs. Our holidays together are here on the Alpen Trail when the dogs come with us.
Christiana Zöllner is Lutz Binzer's partner. She helps him organize the race and acts as his dog handler. Dog handlers don't drive sleds themselves. They assist the mushers.
I'll be happy to step in if Lutz needs a break. I'm quite envious, really, not being able to drive here, although I might find it a bit difficult. I'm very involved here in all the arrangements, and the system works well. I think it might be a bit too much if I was also to drive. There are bad times, such as when a dog is injured or falls ill, or when dogs die. Then I think stamp collecting might be easier, or badminton. But in my heart of hearts, I know that even if I don't drive, I wouldn't miss working with the dogs for the world.
Not many people can afford to keep enough dogs to make up two racing teams. Bernd Dickel is acting as dog handler for his son this year, although he himself has been a passionate participant in sprints for many years. But some of their 15 dogs are too old or too young for the sport, so father and son can only enter one sled for the race.
After we decided to do the Alpen Trail, we spent a long time discussing who would drive. He wanted me to drive because I've been involved in the sport for longer, but I said youth should take precedence, although secretly I do envy him the experience, because it's a totally new experience. Seeing the dogs rise to a long-distance challenge. They've run better and better each day.
The Alpen Trail is 300 kilometers long and covers a difference in altitude of 8,000 meters. Anyone who wants to succeed here needs to be able to pace himself and his dogs. No one can set off at full tilt and maintain that speed through to the finish. The team cover around 50 kilometers a day, and time and again, the mushers encounter mountain panoramas that make the Alpen Trail a breathtaking visual experience. At the Dolomytos Museum in Innichen, Michael Wachtler invites visitors to time travel through the history of the mountains. He's fascinated by long-lost worlds, traces of which he has discovered among the peaks of his homeland.
I've spent my whole life in the mountains looking for crystals. One day when I was exploring a wall in the Prags Mountains, I split a stone slab and found myself looking at a beautiful fern leaf. I discovered a primeval paradise.
For visitors to the museum he created, Michael Wachtler commissioned models of the long extinct species he discovered on his excursions into the Dolomites.
Here we have a piece of seashore from 250 million years ago. A dinosaur like this one with a long tail probably ran across this shore. Here we can still see the track left by its tail as it moved. And to the left and right we see the claw prints.
These giant primeval clams were once believed to be woodland spirits' footprints. Others were held to be petrified sunbeams.
The Plätzwiese is one of the few places in the world where you can still find a petrified coral garden. Beneath the paws of the sled dogs that are now running across it is a petrified ocean bed.
From the Schluderbach, 500 meters below, the mushers make their way back to the Plätzwiese. The steep climb is 6 kilometers long, a distance which the sleds cover in less than 15 minutes. Despite the long haul, the fastest teams still average speeds of more than 20 kilometers an hour. Minor upsets are common, mostly due to a momentary lapse in concentration. They happen even to experienced mushers like Sylvia Ulrich. At the finish is a small celebration. One is held every day. Sylvia celebrates the fact that she and her 6 dogs are still in second place behind Bjørn Petersen. And applause for Norwegian Marte Heilemann, who leads the field in the large 8-dog sled class. Marte took a break last year because she had a baby. This year, she's surprising everyone with her times.
The trails are very fast this year and very good. It's great fun, but the competition is really tough. I got off to a bit of a bad start this time. Normally I win this race.
But the Alpen Trail isn't really decided until the last leg. That starts 20 kilometers away, in Sexton, in the next valley. Sexton is a picturesque Dolomite village that shows no sign today that in 1915, during the First World War, it was totally obliterated by Italian incendiary grenades. When the magical world of the Dolomites became a battleground, the small mountain village was caught between the fronts. After more than a half-hour drive, Lutz Binzer and Christiana Zöllner arrive at the next location.
Before sled dogs, I had a German shepherd. My hobbies were mountaineering and whitewater canoeing, and I wanted a dog as a companion. But German shepherds have problems with the cold. So I decided on huskies. And they showed me how little I knew about dogs. They simply ran off. That's where I learned that it's not enough for a dog just to go walkies. It needs a task. So I harnessed the huskies to my bike and had some hair-raising rides. Then I bought a training cart and the bug was born. I entered for my first race and came in second. And that, of course, sparked ambition.
He wanted to get faster and faster, which is why he finally switched to hounds.
With eight like this one, we'd be unbeatable. He has all the right qualities. He responds very well to commands. But a dog has to want to run and has to be smart, and this one certainly fits the bill.
It's amazing to see how mushers like Heini Winter manage to keep discipline in a large team.
You should treat dogs equally, just as you would treat children. You shouldn't show favor to one or the other. There's always one that responds better or maybe runs better, and that will be your favorite. But you shouldn't show it.
Nike, one of Sylvia and Alfred's dogs, is lovesick. So Sylvia, who wants to defend her second place in the sixth dog class, has a problem.
We have an awkward situation. A bitch is on heat, and I have a male as a lead dog, and of course I can't put them in a harness together.
The mass start in Sexton is a real spectacle. In the confusion, it's hard to see what's happening ahead. A spectator has ignored the safety barrier. Lutz, number 20, gets away first. But where's Sylvia?
The bitch I chose to put up front in place of my first choice wouldn't run. The barking and so many teams around her put her off. She's not a cool character. She won't just ignore everything and run. She's a cautious dog, and she decided to stay put.
Eventually, Sylvia did persuade her wary dog to move, but she set off at the back of the field. Today is the last day of the race. The route is 55 kilometers and covers a difference in altitude of 2,000 meters. It's the hardest leg of the Alpen Trail, and a lot can still happen. At the Kreuzberg Pass, Lutz Binzer has some unexpected downtime. His dogs went the wrong way. At one time, Kreuzberg marked the border with Italy. In the First World War, the walls and crenellations of these rocks, long thought to be unscalable, were the trenches. The carnage continued for 2.5 years. A German dog unit was also involved in the Alpine War. Its job was to transport ammunition and supplies into the impassable wilderness. Beyond the Kreuzberg Pass, the Alpen Trail leads into the neighboring province of Belluno and up to the alpine pasture land of Coltrondo Alm. The pastures here are actually owned by an Italian farmers' cooperative, but they've been managed for a number of years by the South Tyrolean Meyer family from Sexton. Before the first guests arrive, Italian and South Tyrolean specialities are prepared. Justina cuts the dough for ravioli, and Litti Meyer forms bacon dumplings.
We get along fine with the Italians. Things were still a bit difficult 20 years ago because Kreuzberg formed a border and made for very little contact. So there were a few preconceived ideas on both sides.
Integrating into Italy was a long and painful process for the South Tyroleans, but now they benefit from being bilingual.
We have advantages. We are close to Sexton. We speak German, we speak Italian, and that brings definite advantages for running a place like this. An Italian who only speaks Italian would certainly have more problems. Today we're glad we have Italian guests. They're a mainstay of our business. It's hard to say which we get more of, Italian or German-speaking guests.
The race continues along the Karnic Alps, very close to the Austrian border. What makes a good team? Discipline, for one thing. The dogs need to ignore distractions. But the dogs also have to want to run, so the musher has to keep their spirits up. If he fails to do that, he has lost.
We have one contestant with hounds who is coming in last and is well over the time limit, but it's not always the dogs that are to blame. My first wins were with dogs that other mushers dismissed as being not very special. I'm convinced that if the relationship between man and dog is right, you can get good performances even out of a dog that's not generally regarded as a top performer.
The right position needs to be found for every dog.
What doesn't work is just going out and buying six dogs to make a team. A team needs to grow together. A team has to take shape slowly. You have to try out the dogs in different positions. Not every dog is a leader.
Lead dogs have to be particularly intelligent. They respond to the commands and set the pace.
We have one dog that will never go in front. In fact, it's only happy at the back because it feels insecure when there's another dog behind it. And that's a definite no-no for a lead dog, of course.
It takes time to build up a team, but it's a fascinating process.
For a musher, happiness is sensing the dogs doing their best, charging over the snow in perfect harmony. In less than 2 hours, the first teams are already at the finish in Sexton. Waiting for them is the luckless Heini Winter, who had to scratch because of a cold. So he's the first to congratulate Marte Heilemann, who's already a clear winner.
Congratulations, Marte.
After 8 days, the mushers are exhausted, the elation subdued. In Europe, where sled dog racing is a purely amateur sport and there's no big prize money, everything is more relaxed. No careers are made, but everyone enjoys their own personal triumphs. Martin Dickel is pleased as punch.
Und Martin, schafft,
ist gut. Ja, super, ja.
Best day of all. Went like a dream. Great run.
I'm not sure it was enough. I was very slow today. Fingers crossed.
Suvia needs to put on a brave face. All of her team had a bad day today.
It was a pretty chaotic run, but things don't always go according to plan. The bitches on heat, and the male dogs hadn't had a drink because they were so lovesick. So they ate snow, of course, and that upset them. Things just didn't work out this time.
Everyone has a tale to tell. Marte almost crashed into another team. Heini Winter can only listen today and accept commiserations. It's a real downer having to scratch on the last day, Lutz Binzer explains, because the dog's performance gets better as the race goes on. And then there's the celebrating, which Heini Winter doesn't think he'll be joining in. Those who came through are absolutely buzzing, as Claudia Falk readily confirms. But after the race is before the race. Next year they'll be back here again, forming up with their teams to face the challenge of the Alps.
We'll definitely be back next year. The decision has already been made. We're already thinking what we could do better.
I'm in this sport because it's exciting. You never know what the day will bring.
It sounds crazy, but once you start dog sledding, you never want to stop.